Hey everybody, thanks for tuning in. I'm Zach Peterson, I'm a technical consultant with Altium, and today we're gonna continue the discussion with connectors and connector pinouts, and I'm gonna show you something pretty cool and pretty useful, hopefully you find it useful. It's called a rotation-proof connector pinout. This is something I had to do in a recent project, and I realized it would be super useful if more people knew about it, so I definitely wanna show it to you today. So I'm really excited to show this to you, let's get into it. The easiest way to see how to do this is to look at like a two row pin header. So I'm just gonna draw something out here that's a two row pin header. So on my two row pin header, I have, let's say, a number of different IOs and power and ground. And the idea here is I need to arrange them in some way such that if I take this, pin header, let's say it's a ribbon cable, and I rotate it and plug it back in, that I'm gonna have the same pinout matching on both ends of the connection. When I first tried to visualize this and think about how to do this, I was a little lost and I admittedly wasn't quite sure where to start. So here I've got a 10-pin pin header, and on this type of thing, essentially what you need to do is just try and think about what's gonna happen if I take this pin and swap it for this pin. What's gonna happen if I take this pin and swap it for this pin? Am I still gonna have the same pinout? Now, this is really useful if you have a bunch of boards that are gonna be daisy chained and they're gonna be lined up in a long row. So you need to feed one board into the next board, into the next board, and you need to make sure that those pinouts are always gonna match as you move down that chain. So to do a rotation-proof connector pinout, first we need to look at what happens if we exchange, say, this pin with this pin or this pin with this pin. So what that means is that these two pins need to have the same net. These two pins need to have the same net, and so on and so forth. I'm just gonna go through a really simple example. Let's say we have some power, we have some ground, and we have some IOs. So first, if I assign this to be power, and let's say I assign this to be ground, then I need to do the same over here, but in reverse. So this would be power, and this would be ground. Pretty simple, right? Let's say I make this my IO number one. That means this also needs to be IO number one. And if I make this IO two, the next one needs to be IO two, and so on and so forth, okay? And then I've got two leftover pins. You could leave this as unconnected, and let's say you did that. If you did that, you would also have to leave this one unconnected. Generally, I always say, don't leave a pin unconnected, just ground that sucker. But if you ground this one, you also got to ground this one. So again, just visually, if I take this and I rotate it, I'm going to get the same pin out no matter what. You'll notice that we have some pins that are adjacent to each other with the same net. Here, these are adjacent to each other with the same net. So what's the best way to connect these two to make sure that you've got the same signal always going into these two pins? Well, on the PCB, what you can do is you can have copper that just bridges these two. This could go to, let's say, the ground plane. So let's say you've got here going over to a via, and this goes to a ground plane. This could come over and go to a via. That could be your ground plane. Same thing over here. Go to our ground plane. Go to our ground plane. With power, our power line, I'm gonna draw it in green. Let's say you have a power plane or you have a power rail on an internal layer. This could go to your power rail. This could also go to your power rail. And then you've got these IO1 guys hanging out here. So this is where connector pinouts can get a little difficult, because sometimes what you might need to do is use the back layer. And if you use the back layer, you would then need to have vias coming off and going to the back layer. Generally, it's not a good idea to try and route this big long line all the way around. It's preferable to use a short connection between these two, at least in my opinion. In certain cases though, if you need to route a big line around this to get to that other IO, you might not have a choice. Again, you just need to balance the need to make sure that this is rotation proof from an engineering and connectivity concept perspective versus the need to make sure that all of the connections are really short. So if you're really creative with how you group all your different pins together, you can actually make this thing rotation proof. And sometimes to be able to do that, instead of using something with an odd number of pins in each row, you might want to actually use something with an even number of pins in each row. So let's look at that. In the previous example, we looked at one that had 5 pins in a row. And when you have that odd number of pins, sometimes it might be a little difficult to create a pinout that's actually rotation proof, especially when you have these IOs in the center that start to cross over each other. Here, this is actually going to be a little bit easier. So I'm going to do the same number of signals, right? 2 IOs, power and ground. And we're going to look at how that turns out. So here, a good strategy is, again, we have our power and we have our ground. Again, down here, we have our power, we have our ground, and I want to look in the center just for the moment. So if this is IO1, this has to be IO1, and if this is IO2, then this also has to be IO2. So now that they're really close together like this, even though they cross over each other, if I'm on a multi-layer board, what I can do is I can bridge these two on one layer, and then I can bridge these two on the other layer. So this is really nice when they're like this, because then I don't have to route all the way around on a different layer, and you can just really nicely connect the two pads on the PCB in the footprint, or preferably not in the footprint, but you could do it in the footprint. Or you can just route a little bit of copper in the PCB layout, and it'll just bridge these two holes, and that's it. Here, this is also really good because we've got power and ground, ground and power, but I could have a different power level if I wanted to, right? So let's just say that up here in this top power is, let's say it's 5 volts. That means this also has to be 5 volts. We could also have 3V3 somewhere, okay? So this could also be power, but at 3V3 going right here. And if that one's 3V3, this one also has to be power at 3.3 volts. And then you've still got these last two left over. Just for the heck of it, let's make this ground, and then let's make this ground. And we're done. So just by extending the pin header by 2 pins, pretty small extension, you're able to create this nice, easy connection between the IOs. You've also created some additional space if you need to have some additional power and another ground pin. And this is all done. This is rotation proof. Okay, so hopefully this gives you some ideas for how to design your own connector pin out. Take this advice, take the advice in the previous video, put it all together, and you know just about everything you need to know about connector pinouts. What we're gonna look at in an upcoming video is what should you do when you have an earth connection somewhere in the system, and if you should route that over your connector. This is actually a complex topic. Pretty much anything to do with grounding can be pretty complex, and I've seen experts get it wrong, I've seen experts get it right. So I'm gonna run over some of the advice that I know of, and hopefully it'll help you with your design process. So when you want to design a connector pinout like this that's totally rotation proof, you need the best PCB design software. Go check out Circuit Maker. It's super easy to use, it's free to download, and if you're still learning PCB design, it's a great tool for you to learn the process and the practice of PCB design before you move on to a more advanced program like Altium Designer. Make sure to hit the like button, hit the subscribe button, leave some comments. We love getting your questions. Check out the links in the description if you want to learn more. And don't forget to call your fabricator, folks.